Are you trying to design a game but are not sure what steps to follow in the design process? By the end of this video, you're going to learn the essential steps in the design process so you can make sure that every game you're making follows the correct path. Whether you're working on a game by yourself or with a company, I'm going to share the essential steps in the game design process that I follow every day as a professional game designer. For the best game design tips and advice, please subscribe to my channel. Also, please hit the bell button so you're notified when I upload my next video. The first thing you need to be doing is research. A lot of people miss this step and go straight to developing the game, but this step is crucial in the game design process. Research allows you to get information on possible mechanics that could work together and provides overall inspiration from various types of creative work. It is important to remember that in this phase, you're not just going to be playing games. While that is definitely important, I also recommend that you look at other forms of art and how they approach things in those different mediums. You can watch movies, works of art, music, literature, etc. All of those things can provide valuable information on why something has good design or not. For example, if you watch a specific movie that makes you sad, study it and learn why it makes you sad. Is it the camera angles, the color palette, or maybe how they tell the story? Make sure to study that, because that will be valuable when you need to make the player feel sad. It is also important to play games, but not just to play them for the sake of having fun. You have to play them with the intent of researching them and understanding them at a deeper level. As you're playing, think about why the developers designed the level the way they did, or why a certain mechanic works the way it does. By doing this, you're going to learn a lot about game design. This will give you valuable experience which your games is going to benefit from in the long run. It will also save you a lot of time and headaches going back and forth with iterations down the line. The second thing that you need to do in your design process is brainstorming. In this step, I recommend grabbing a notebook and taking it anywhere you go. You will be surprised because you'll notice your brain will come up with ideas at random times. Yet, you'll be prepared to document them. The key is that you keep a record of them, which is why having a notebook is important. Pay attention to the events and surroundings in your life. It is likely this will help inspire a new mechanic or game idea when you least expect it. Remember, no idea is good or bad, it's just an idea. Document it without judging whether it's going to be great or not. For example, the game Papers, Please was inspired because its creator Lucas Pope used to travel a lot and spend a lot of time in lines in the airport. That simple life experience became one of the most successful games of recent times. Who would have thought something as annoying as waiting at an airport could be a source of inspiration? The point is, make sure to not overlook anything. Even if it seems like a waste of time, just write it down and worry about it later. It is also important to have your notebook by your bed. I sometimes find myself dreaming about something cool and randomly wake up in the middle of the night to write it down. As you start evaluating your ideas, choose the ones that are more interesting to you and narrow the list down to start working on them. Once you have just one main idea, start brainstorming different options around that specific idea. The goal is to keep you focused on one main idea at a time so your mind doesn't run wild. It's all about streamlining your creative effort. The third step is to prototype, which I have talked about before. Prototyping is one of the best things you can do as a designer to save a lot of time. As you prototype, you're going to find out whether a specific mechanic is working how you intended it for it to work in a timely manner. The alternative is fully developing it, spending a bunch of time on it only to discover that it isn't working and having to discard it completely. Prototyping is great because the design process requires a lot of iteration, so this helps reduce rework by modifying things as you test them, taking trial and error to a whole other level. Another great advantage of prototypes is that they don't have to be digital. You can work perfectly through paper prototypes to check quickly if a mechanic is worth your time or not. Also, by prototyping, you can iterate faster and find new or better designs for your game sooner and well before you go into scripting them. One more thing to discuss in regards to prototypes is that the simpler they are, the better. If you are trying to make a 3D game, instead of having to program physics, mechanics, and so on, maybe try to do them first in 2D, which is simpler. I highly recommend you take a look at Zelda Breath of the Wild GDC talk. It is not only inspiring, but also very educational for anyone who is interested in game design as a career. I won't spoil it for you, but the key takeaway is that they used an engine based on the first Zelda to prototype the Breath of the Wild mechanics. Imagine how much time that saved them. The first step is to playtest, and I know I sound like a broken record, but trust me, it is one of the most important steps. Playtesting is crucial in design. You have to have people play the game, because in reality, they are the ones who are going to play it in the end, not you. You need to know who your target audience is, and what kind of players your game is targeting. Once you know that, I would recommend you playtest the game once a week, or even more often, if you find it necessary. By doing this, you have the ability to change things more often. As a result, this will ensure you don't make too much progress, only to then realize everything you work on is not going to work in the end. You can playtest with a bunch of different people. It can be your friends, family, strangers, or someone else. The characteristics of a good playtester are good communication, being outspoken, and being honest. The more honest the playtest, the better feedback you will get. Playtesting also ensures that people enjoy your game, but most importantly, that they understand it. In this step, it is crucial to be open to critical feedback and not be too attached to your ideas. That way, you can take feedback seriously and act on it to really improve your game. Remember not to take it too personal. The goal is to improve the game, and remember, there is never going to be a perfect game. You just decide to stop working on it and improving it. The fifth step is to iterate. After you have a playtest, you are probably going to have some notes about what you need to change or adapt in your game. It is important that this information gets acted on and is not left in the notebook. After you iterate, you are probably going to have to go back and playtest some more, just to make sure that people still understand the game and it is still fun for them. This process can take a while, and I can assure you that you are going to be playtesting and iterating a lot in your game. Basically, it becomes a cycle in which you need to go from iteration to playtest, then back to iteration and back to playtest. Sometimes, you will even find out that you need to go back to prototype again, or maybe do more research if a lot of things go wrong. Just remember that you already got here, so don't give up and keep pushing. Your final game is just around the corner. Once you feel the game is in a good place, you can move on to the sixth step and last step in our design process. But keep in mind that you shouldn't fall into the never-ending cycle of iteration. At a certain point, you need to just trust what you're doing and go with it. Otherwise, you're never going to finish that game. Keep in mind that iterative design's main purpose is to limit the amount of work that goes in the trash. While you're iterating, make sure that everything you're working on is as simple to do as possible. For example, if you're iterating art, use concept art instead of actual 3D models. If you are iterating mechanics, use paper prototypes instead of coding in an engine, and so on. The more you do this, the more time you are going to save in your project. The sixth and last step is to ship the game. This is the step in which you apply all that you learned in all of the different previous phases and put it all together. This is the only step that matters in the end, getting your game in customer hands. And of course, it is easier said than done. A lot of things can go wrong, and even when everything goes right, a game is never 100% complete. You can always do more to it or improve it in some way. So for this stage, I recommend to just ship it once you feel you have a good enough game. It is never going to be perfect, and if you want it to be, you are never going to ship it. Try to focus on finishing it and release it for the world to experience. You will feel very accomplished by doing so, and the next game you make will be much better because of that first experience you had.
And that's it, you guys. Thank you so much for watching. What is the design process that you follow when making a game? Please let me know in the comment section below. Also, if you like this video, please hit the like button and share it with your friends. Finally, hit the bell button so you don't miss on my next video. See you next time!